Hey guys, welcome back to another video on my channel. And in today's video, we're going to talk about a very simple yet very interesting concept. So today we're going to talk about why do computers really index from 0 and not from 1? Okay, I'm pretty sure a lot of you have been confused as programmers as well when you hit multiple array out of bounds errors and all of that. So we're going to cover that in today's video. So let's quickly get started. Alright, so here is my presentation. So we're going to talk about two major things today. One is zero-based indexing or numbering, and one is one-based numbering. Okay, you might have hit this quite often as programmers, index out of range or array out of bounds exception or errors while you compile your program or while you run it. Okay, just to give you more context, you can go to Reddit and you can just search for off by one bugs and errors, and you're going to come across really funny stories. Now let's go a little back and go to the year 1982. We have a paper from Dijkstra which actually tries to explain why is this in place. Okay, we're not going to go through the entire paper, but let me pull out a few important details which might be relevant for us. So what happened is Dijkstra just tried finding out different ways to represent these natural numbers, basically from 2 to 12. And there are four representations here, okay, 2 less than equal to I till I less than 13 and so on, okay. And Dijkstra basically had a few remarks and a few theories behind this, and he finally concluded that the first one, 2 lesser than equal to I, which is less than 13, is the best option to represent these numbers, okay. He also goes ahead and proves that if you have n numbers, representing them from 0 till I less than n is a much cleaner approach than starting from 1 and going till the nth element. Okay, so this is what we take away from this paper, and this is where it all began. I also have the link to the paper in the description, so you can go and check it out if you're interested. So now let's get into the practicality of it. Okay, let's understand what an index is. So basically an index just represents the offset from the beginning of a memory address to fetch any element that you request for. So here is a very simple diagram, and this is based on the one base numbering. Okay, so you have 6 elements here and you go from 1 to 6. The indexes start from 1 and it goes all the way till 6, and this does not start from 0 because this is one based indexing. Okay, and what happens when you want to fetch any element in this? Okay, let's say you want to fetch the third element. Okay, in that case, what would happen is it would ideally be element of n equal to address. Address here stands for the base address. Okay, the address here that you get for the first element. Okay, this base address plus n minus 1 into size of the element. What does this really mean? Okay, let's go back to the diagram. Here we talk about third element that we want. If we want this element, we should get the address of this block, right? And for that, what should we do? We should take the base address and add 2 times the size of each of these blocks to reach the third block, right? You cannot add 3 times the address of size of each block. So ideally, if you look at it in terms of a mathematical formula, you do n minus 1 into size of the element. Okay, here, if you assume that the size of each element is same in the array, in that case, let's assume the size is 5 or whatever, then it will be 5 into 3 minus 1, which is 2, which is 10. Okay, base address plus 10 will give you the third element. Okay, similarly, what would happen if it is a zero-based indexing? If you want the third element, ideally the index would be 2 and not 3. So when you want element of 2, which is actually a third element, you just take the base address and add n into size of the element again. And if you notice carefully, you're not actually doing n minus 1 here. Okay, this is an important difference to note. We will come back to this at the end of the presentation again and dig a little more deeper. So for now, let us go even more practical. Let us take the example of a language. And today we're just going to choose C because it's much simpler and understood by a wider audience. So here I just have the primary logic of the code. I don't have hash include and function definitions and all of that. So let's assume you have declared an array of two integers. Okay, and I've also defined that the integers are 0 and 1. I'm simply trying to print the 0th index and the first index element. Okay, a of 0 and a of 1. And this is what you get as an output as expected, right? Now let's add a pointer to this. Let's take a pointer star p here and assign it a. Now let's try to understand what an array is. Whenever you try to request for an array in C, you basically get back a pointer, but along with that, you also get the size of till where the array can be extended to. Okay, so if you request for two elements, you're gonna get, let's say this, if it's an int array, you're gonna get the size of an int and multiply that by two. That's how much space you get for an array. Okay, that's quite obvious. So when you try to assign a to star p, basically, you're just getting the address, base address of the array and putting it to the pointer. Now, let's try manipulating one of the values in the array. Okay, we again have the same code wherein you're trying to assign a pointer p with the value of address of a. What I'm additionally doing here is I'm going to take the first index and I'm going to put the value of 10 to it. Okay, an interesting thing to note here is even though I'm declaring a of 2 here, it basically means I just want an array of two elements. It does not mean I want a of 0, 1 and 2. Okay, that is something you need to understand. So let's look at this example wherein I'm going to reassign the value of the first index to 10. So it was 1 initially and I'm trying to make it 10. So as we see, the output actually returns back 10. Okay, a of 1 actually gets modified even when you do this operation with a pointer. Now let's go into the basics of pointer arithmetic just to give you more context about this. We are again assigning the address of a to pointer p, and in this case we are not printing out the value of a as such, but we are trying to print out the addresses present in the pointer. Okay, so first we just print out simple p, which is the address of a, the base address that you received. And the next part that I'm interested in here is I'm trying to add 2 to the address and I'm trying to print that. And let's see what happens now. Okay, as you know, addresses are represented in hex. So you can kind of ignore this entire part and just focus on the last three digits or the last two digits. So if you notice, p had a value of 60 and p plus 2 had a value of 68. This means we added 2 here, p. We just added 2 to p, and you still see like 8 getting added. So it doesn't really sum up. What is happening? If we go back to the basics of pointer arithmetic, what happens is when I add 2 to p, it is basically taking the value stored in p, which is the address. Okay, it's taking the address which is stored in the pointer. This is not address of pointer, but address stored in pointer. And what you do is you add 2 times the size of the data type. In this case, the size data type here is integer. So you're gonna get size of is 4, and you're gonna multiply that by 2. So you get 8, and 8 plus base address which was assigned to p will give you the 68. Okay, this is exactly what is happening. Now let us go back to the point where we initially began. So if you remember this was for the one based indexing method, and this was for the zero based indexing method. Okay, so if we had followed one based indexing method, we actually had to do an additional operation of subtracting 1 from the offset, right, to get the element. You cannot directly go and multiply the number times the size of the element and then add it to the base address to reach the element. You have to subtract 1 from the element that you want, the position of the element that you want, and only then you can retrieve the element. So this basically adds one level of additional complexity of some extra work to your processor, wherein it has to process one extra instruction. And to reduce that, they have very intelligently just followed zero-based indexing. And that's the reason we all follow this scheme here. Okay. I think things are pretty clear now that we know why we actually index from 0 and not from 1. Even though I make the statement, there are quite a few languages which do have indexes which start from 1, and the best example for that would be Fortran or COBOL or any of these languages. So yes, most of the languages these days usually try to use zero-based indexing because of this. And you might have also heard a lot of programmer jokes wherein, you know, people just randomly use zero-based indexing or zero-based counting in their real life, and then, you know, they get fooled upon by others. That is all I had for this video. I hope you got to learn about why indexing starts from zero in arrays and lists and all of that. So please do subscribe to my channel if you did like the video and if you would like to see more such videos on your YouTube. Thank you for watching.